Then I would like to say welcome to everybody and thank you for joining us today. So, as you might know, we have been having these two learning blocks and webinars before, which were about both meteorological and then hydrological droughts. And so today we would like to kind of dig a bit deeper into hydrological droughts and hydrological drought modeling and look at how especially data from the GRAY satellite mission can be used to inform the models and the drought forecasting. And for this purpose, I'm very glad to be joined by Helena Gärtner from the University of Bonn, which is one of our project partners, as well as Frank Flechtner from the German Geo Research Center. And yeah, I would just like to. So, well, for the program today, we're going to have lectures from each of our presenters each, which are going to be like 15 minutes. Then we're going to have maybe half an hour of discussion afterwards. So, I would like to give the word to Mr. Frank Flechtner for the first presentation.
Yeah, hello everyone. As Yannick already said, I'm Frank Flechner from the German Research Center for Geoscience in Potsdam, but I'm actually here located in Oberpfaffenhofen near Munich. I'm the co-PI of the GRACE mission and also responsible for the implementation and operation of the GRACE follow-on mission contributions from Germany. And I was asked to introduce a little bit how the measurement principle of GRACE is, which data products we generate, and let's say where the pros and cons of such kind of mission are to provide total water storage or mass transport in system Earth. So, how do I get to the next slide?
On the bottom, on the lower left part.
Now I see. Thank you. So, for those who do not know it, GRACE is an abbreviation for Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment. This satellite mission consists of a twin satellite pair. And what we are doing is we observe the relative motion of these two satellites in space. And this is the experiment. And GRACE and GRACE follow-on are the only missions which are in space which are able to observe mass transport. And mass transport is related to a lot of climate change-related issues, such as variations in the global water cycle, where we are talking today about, like groundwater depletion, drought, flooding, and so on. But it is also connected with ice melting in large glacier systems or sea level rise. The measurement principle is easily explained if you think about, let's say, gravitational law, where you have two bodies. One can be assumed is the Earth, and the second one is one of our two satellites, and then the axial force between these two bodies, which is proportional to the product of the two masses, the gravitational constant, and it is decreasing with the power of two between the two bodies. And if you think now about the GRACE mission, which is flying in about 490 kilometers, in a distance of about 220 kilometers. And the first satellite is reaching a mountain, for example, here, the Himalaya, as an example. It is accelerated a little bit towards this additional mass. And the second satellite in 220 kilometers does not feel so much this gravitational force. And you see this in a certain distance between the two satellites. And if they fly further, you see that now the gravitational force is more or less similar if the two satellites are flying directly over this mass. And the distance between the two satellites has decrease a little bit. And if the satellites continue their way on the orbit, the separation increases once again, because now the second satellite is accelerated towards the Mars, and the first one is already flying, let's say, into flight direction. So that is, in principle, a movie which should explain you that this distance between the two satellites should change continuously, and it is changing continuously here in the 12th digits of this 220 kilometers. Yeah? That means we are measuring tiny difference changes between the two satellites in the order of 1 micrometer or 0.1 micrometer per second, if you think about changes of distance over time. What we have on board these two satellites are GPS receivers to continuously track the position and the velocity of these two satellites. For this is so-called high-low satellite-to-satellite tracking. High-low because we are measuring between a low Earth orbiter and this GPS satellites flying in about 20,000 kilometers or so on. And most important is the so-called low-low satellite tracking between the two satellites, which I have just introduced to you. What we additionally have on board is, in the center of the satellites, an accelerometer, which observes in three axes non-gravitational forces, which are due to forces which has nothing to do with gravitational force, but they are caused by atmospheric drag or solar radiation pressure. We have to know the attitude of the two satellites, which is measured by two star camera heads. This is needed to transform the microwave measurement between the carbon or the microwave horns here, about 1 meter 40 apart from the center of mass of the satellite, to transform this from this phase center to the center of mass. For that, you need to know the attitude precisely, and also to rotate the measurements from the accelerometer frame into the inertial frame. And we have on the bottom of the two satellites, satellite laser ranging retro reflectors, where we can independently control to validate the orbit, which is derived primarily by GPS. If you think about let's say, measurement principle, this movie unfortunately is also not working. It should show you in principle the CHEM satellite, which was a kind of precursor. Which was a precursor of GRACE, a single satellite system. But what we are doing is we observe, let's say, the tiny differences between the observed orbit, the real orbit, and a theoretical orbit, which is computed from the observations and from background models like the gravity field or ocean currents and other models. We observe the ground tracks, let's say, continuously over 1 day, which gives us roughly 16 revolutions for GRACE over 1 day, collect this data over 15 and finally over 30 days. So you can see that this gives a very dense, a good global distribution of observations over the globe. And then we can use, so we can remove this video. We can use all these observations to numerically integrate the orbit, to subdivide, let's say, the equation of motion in gravitational forces, non-gravitational forces measured by the accelerometer, and empirical forces, maybe due to temperature effects acting on the satellites and inside the satellite. Yeah, we need initial position velocity of a satellite, and as I said, all disturbing forces acting on the satellites. And then we variate this initial condition and get at the end by an adjustment process this residuals observed minus computed. And from that we can perform an adjustment process here, where one of the most important data set from the unknowns are the so-called spherical harmonic coefficients, the CLM and SLM, which we derive every month up to degree in order 96, which is about 200 kilometers in spatial scale. So what does that mean? We observe a monthly gravity field as described before, maybe for August 2006. You see that the signal is in the order of plus minus 100 milligal. A milligal, I wrote that here, is 10 power minus 5 meter per second square. And that you can do also for the next month, for September. And if you compare here pixel by pixel, you do not see much differences. And if you build the differences between these two maps, then the important information becomes visible. So this is the time variations of the gravity field. And you see here annual signal of the Amazon in the summer, so from August to September. So that's the interesting contribution of GRACE. This gravity result, which is about 10,000 of a static gravity field, so of a gravity field which is, let's say, valid over many, many years. So we are observing very tiny changes in the gravity field with very tiny observations, as I have explained before, by the microwave system with micrometer accuracy. So what you can get from the GRACE time series, GRACE flew from April April 2004 till June 2017. And you can now analyze every year from January to December, and you see maps of the annual and semi-annual signals here, like before, the Amazon signal, but you see also a lot of signals here, especially in the, let's say, equatorial areas, which describes, for example, variations in monsoon seasons and so on and so forth. And the worth of the GRACE data is also the long time series. So you can take, for example, here the May from every year and make a plot, and you see that in certain areas of the world, there is a decrease of mass, like in Greenland, like in Western Antarctica, like here in Western Alaska, Patagonia, or Himalaya, and so on and so forth. So that's the worth of the GRACE data, that you can observe long time series with let's say, global and homogeneous accuracy. So just an example where the video again does not move, but it doesn't matter. So just to explain you what GRACE provides is here the total water storage, which you see here from month to month. And that's here on the left-hand side. And the total water storage from GRACE is nothing else than the sum of all contributions of the hydrological cycle. So what the groundwater contributes, surface water, snow water equivalent, soil moisture, and runoff. So the sum of all these five must be the total water storage from GRACE, if you believe GRACE. And if you have GRACE data and have information here on the right-hand side, maybe from other satellite systems or from models and archives, you can, for example, reverse this equation and look for groundwater. So I guess Elena will talk much more on these details later on. So this is just an example, looking at ice melting in Greenland on the left, and Antarctica on the right here. You see that especially here in the basin 22 in Antarctica, here in the western part, there's a lot of melting. And here, for example, in the basin number 6, there's not much melting, and for example, also a little bit accumulated snow over time. So in Greenland, for example, we lose about 280 gigatons per year, which has been observed by Grace over this 15 years time frame. I think the final example is the sea level budget. What is observed usually from a measurement system like altimetry satellites is the, let's say, total sea level budget, which is about 3.1 millimeter per year. And since we have GRACE now, we can distinguish what is the impact of mass change in the sea level rise and what is the impact of thermal expansion, which can be observed, for example, by Argo floaters. Last three slides for my short presentation gives you an overview about the GRACE follow-on mission. So I hope that I could already convince you in a few minutes that this 15 years of data had a certain worth to the user community. And NASA and my institute decided in 2009-10 that we need to have a follow-on mission, which was planned till early 18 and then successfully launched into orbit with more or less similar orbit, was launched with the SpaceX provided Falcon 9. And we had a successful in-orbit checkout phase, and the first instrument data, the level one data, have recently been distributed to the user community, and also the gravity maps, the level two data, have been provided end of July for, let's say, analysis by the user community. That GRACE follow-on works, I show you on two examples. You see here the GRACE time series from 2002 till 2017 for Europe. You see here an example for a moderate summer in 2007 here, the red dot. So this is, let's say, normal condition over Europe in that year. And you could see that we had heat waves in 2003, 2015, for example, and everyone in Europe remembers the heat wave in 2018, which becomes visible here in the GRACE follow-on data. So you see here the seasonal signal already in the first 7, 8, 9 monthly products. So the continuation is there. And you can see the heat wave, especially over Europe in October, September, October, 2018. A second example is what I also have talked about, is the mass change contribution to global sea level rise, where you can see here the long-term trend from GRACE and the continuation of GRACE follow-on. So it works. And my last two slides talk about a tech demo instrument. So we are not measuring the intersatellite range change by microwave system, but we have now a so-called laser ranging interferometer on board, which has been implemented into the already very busy satellite. And we see that this measurement works very well. If you zoom into one orbit here, you see here the residuals, what I have talked about, between the observed and the computed range changes. And you see here the large scatter in red from the microwave system and the very smooth laser observations where we hope to get further information on the gravity field. And that is my last slide. If you look on the GRACE measurement principle, you see that there are certain contributors to the overall gravity field measurement error. So we have to have a precise orbit determination. I talked about attitude determination, that we have to measure the non-gravitational forces. We have to precisely measure the intersatellite range between the two satellites. But we have also very carefully to observe models which describe or model shorter mass variations, for example, by pressure changes in the atmosphere, which changes over, let's say, sometimes over some hours, yeah, or the ocean tides, which are also changing within hours. And there were a lot of simulations. I do not go into all the details. This slide should only mention that the range alone, the green curve, yeah, which gives you the signal which you can observe with a laser ranging interferometer compared to a microwave system, which improves the spatial resolution from degree 60 to degree 80. If this curves would not be here, these are the errors coming from the short-term mass variations, which we cannot model perfectly. Yeah? Therefore, scientists are already thinking about launching a successor of GRACE for LOWN, which we call Mass Change Mission, which could be built by a pair of these twin satellites, one flying like GRACE over the poles and one on an inclined orbit. And with that, we hope to bring that curves all down and improve the spatial resolution of the resulting gravity field. So that's in short my introduction to the topic.
All right, thank you so much. So yeah, I think we can just go to the next presentation with Helena.
Yes, hello.
All right, let me. All right, there we go.
Okay, so I'd like to introduce myself again. I'm Helena Gerdner, and I work at the University of Bonn as a PhD student at the Institute of Geodesy and Geoinformation, and I work for the GlobeDrop project. So these webinars are out of different webinars out of the GlobeDrop project. And I want to show the potentials and limitations about the GRACE mission. So to do so, I want to first explain hydrological droughts in the context of the project. And then I will show you how to process total water storage changes. So then we will talk about drought indicators. So we use drought indicators and also analyze them within a synthetic indicator framework. And at the end, I would also like to show you how to combine GRACE with model outputs for hydrological modeling. So the GlobeDrop project is funded by the Federal Ministry of Education and Research. And within this project, we aim to develop a web-based drought information system. And therefore, we compute drought risk by considering the components hazard, vulnerability, and exposure. And the hazard component is consisting out of different drought types. So we consider meteorological droughts, hydrological droughts, and agricultural droughts. And in the last lecture, we already heard from Petra Doyle that we can use model outputs to consider hydrological droughts, but we can also use GRACE to do so. So, and therefore, we first look at the global water cycle. You already heard that we have different compartments and storages. So we have, for example, stream flow, groundwater, or different freshwater sources. And using only these single storages for drought monitoring can be a problem, because maybe we have a drought in another storage than we are looking at. So drought can, for example, occur in groundwater while we only look at stream flow. And then we have another problem, because the measurements of stream flow and groundwater, for example, are very difficult to retrieve. So therefore, we use GRACE because we look at total water storage changes. We heard that total water storage changes are the sum of all storages. So we have, for example, groundwater and snow, and so on, and then we sum it up to get the total water storage changes. So GRACE has high potential to get real observations of these changes. Yeah, and in the last talk, we already heard about the mission, the measurements, and how we can get gravity potential coefficients. These coefficients are typically called level 2 solutions, and we now take these solutions and transform them to level 3 solutions, which are total water storage changes. And therefore, we need to do some processing. And this contains that we replace lower degree coefficients, we do some spatial filtering, we average time series, and then we transform it to the total water storage changes. And these solutions still have some effects in it that we remove. So typically done is also a removal of glacial isostatic adjustment. And here at our institute, we also do an earthquake removal because these signals also have an influence on the gravitational potential. And now I will show you two examples of this transformation process because we want to show why we do these things. So here the spatial filtering. On the left you see the unfiltered solution for January 2005, and you see that we have stripes in the direction north to south, and these hinder us to detect the correct hydrological signal. And on the right, you see now the filtered solution. Here we used a DDK3 filter, and you see that it is more easier to analyze the results now. These stripes occur due to the measurement constellations. And the second effect I want to show you is glacial isostatic adjustment. So this is an effect that occurs due to the last ice age. So during the last ice age, we had huge ice sheets on the Earth. And after the ice age, they melted, but the Earth is still responding to these ice, these missing masses. So we have a falling and rising of the Earth still due to these masses. Okay, so we have the finished total water storage changes now and want to make some drought analysis. We can do this by analyzing the pure time series, but typically done in drought analysis is also the computation of indicator drought indicators. And there exist a few indicators. I will only show two examples here. The first one is the DSI, which was implemented in Zhao et al. And the second one is the DEI, and this methodology was applied in Hoburg et al. And I just used the two to show some aspects there, because when you look at East Brazil now, so here we see that we have, using the DSI, we have a high intensity of drought, exceptional drought, while we here see not that strong intensity. So here we have severe drought. So this means that the indicator computation always leads to different results, because we have no universal methodology between the drought indicators. But we do not know yet which of the drought detection is now correct. So this is the reason. Okay, Neil. There exist also other aspects like temporal differences and so on. And this is the reason why we invented a synthetic framework. So within this framework, we wanted to validate our indicators, and we want to compare and extend grace-based indicators. Then we wanted to show how the drought signal that is there propagates through the indicators. And there also exist some grace-related signals like linear trends and spatial noise that also propagate through the indicators that might bias our drought detection. These aspects are not only relevant for the grace indicators, you can also adapt this framework to meteorological indicators. So also these indicators are affected by such effects. So let's go to the synthetic framework that we invented. The aim was that we simulated total water storage changes. So we are here at the end, which is our aim. Therefore, we used real observations by GRACE and analyzed them in specific regions. these regions, then within these regions we extracted signals like trends, temporal correlations, or spatial noise, and so on. So these parts here. And we also added a drought signal. This is very important now because by knowing how long the drought signal is and how intense it is in the input time series, we then know what the indicator outcome should be. And then we can say if the indicator worked correctly or not. Okay, so I also talked about extension of hydrological drought indicators. So we used these indicators from Zhao et al. And Hoburg et al. And replaced the total water storage changes that I used for it. So first, we did something that is also done in meteorological indicators. We used accumulated total water storage changes instead of total water storage changes. And the second one is that we also used different total water storage changes. And then we got out of it four new indicators. So the DSI with accumulated and differenced total water storage changes. And the same for the Hoburg indicator, the DIA and DID. So here's some results of our synthetic experiments. On the upper part, you see the indicator DSI, which was the original indicator. And you can see that we have a dry period here in 2005. So this was the drought period that we synthetically invented. It was from January to August. But you also see that this here in the back is also detected as drought. So you also should know that we show the area in percentage of the DSI. So this is a synthetic region, and we wanted to show which strength of drought is there. And this part here shows that we detected even exceptional drought here in end of the time series, although we have not invented there a drought period. So this means that a trend or an acceleration, this could be both, biases our indicator. And we also see that within this drought period, we do not have exceptional drought. This is what we put into the indicator, but we have in nearly all grid sales, we have only moderate drought, at least. Yeah. So this is also a disadvantage of this indicator. When we look now at the right part, this was a different region for synthetic time series. So SR stands for South Africa, EB stands for East Brazil. These were synthetic time series within these regions, but not the real time series. In the right part, you see now that we do not have a trend in it. So you see the indicator works now correctly because we identify nearly all grid sales exceptional drought. So yeah, this indicator could work if we have no trend in it for this specific drought period. When you look now at the middle figures, here we use DSIA6, which means accumulated for 6 months. We have still a trend in it, but you see now that we have severe drought within the drought period. So we have a higher drought type than before. This is due to the smoothness of the indicator. So the accumulation leads to a smoother indicator, which also leads to a smoothed detection of drought types. Yeah. But again, still influenced by the trend. When you look at the right part now, where no trend was in the original time series, you see that we can again detect the drought period, but it is a bit, little bit longer. Now at the bottom part, you see the DSI with differenced total water storage changes. And there we have no trend anymore included in the time series. So this difference indicator has the advantage that it is not biased by trends, but we also see that it is very noisy compared to the other indicators. And the drought is shortened, but we have the correct draw type identified. So we have a very high percentage of exceptional drought in there. So this should show you that each indicator has its advantages and disadvantages, but we cannot say which indicator is the best for each application. So this was a framework to detect the biases and to get knowledge how they behave. Yeah, so we saw now that we are able to detect droughts by using grace-based indicators, but grace has also some challenges. When you look at the map of Australia here now, you see precipitation in this area. And the precipitation is very local. This means the drought also can be very local. When you compare it now to the grace map, you see that we have a very smooth pattern, and this is due to the resolution of grace. It is a resolution of about 300 kilometers, and it could maybe in some cases be too coarse for using in hydrological monitoring and forecasting systems. So to show up, we have on the left, we have our grace observations, which are real observations, but we use only total water storage changes, not the sub storages. And on the right, we also heard in a webinar that we can use model outputs, for example, WGHM for detecting hydrological drought. So what we do now is that we combine both sources. So we combine both to get the advantages of both. For grace, it is the real observations, so we get the truth. And for the model, it is that we have a vertical higher resolution. So we kind of downscale grace to the vertical higher resolution of the compartments, also a spatial higher resolution with a 50 kilometers resolution, and we can also get daily values out of the model. We combine both by using the ensemble-based Kalman filter. I will only show the rough idea. So we have a beginning state at time point T0, which is here the black dot. And then we make ensembles, so we perturb our state. We forecast it. We have forecasted different ensembles, and then we get the mean out of it. And this mean is then compared to the real observation. And then we kind of meet in the middle to get the actualized state. And then we repeat the whole process. So we perturb our state, forecast it, and combine it with the observation. So here a little example for the Murray-Darling River Basin. We have the in red the grace time series, which has, for example, here in year 2007, a dry period. And when we look at the blue time series now, we have the model output. So the model output is a little bit drier in the period before 2007. Then it misses the drought event in 2007, and after it, it is higher than the observation. So when we look now at the green time series, which is the combined product, you see that the model got closer to the observation. We then also see the dry event in 2007. And what also the advantage is, what is not shown here in this figure, is that we have now the higher vertical and spatial resolution. So then I would like to come to my conclusions. You saw what we do to process grace data to derive total water storage changes. And I hope I could show you how to detect drought by using drought signal, drought indicators, but also how the drought indicators are biased by other grace-based signals. And at the end, I also want to remind you that we combine the advantages of real observation of grace and model outputs to get the advantages of both. And I would also like to remind you that the next learning block is about soil moisture drought. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, thank you so much, both of you. Very interesting. So
yeah,
now, We are just going to go to the discussion part of this webinar. And so there are two ways you can ask questions. The first one is if you want to speak and use your microphone, you can click on the button in the top of the window where it is like raising your hand. Then we can open your microphone. Or if you prefer, you can just write a question in the text chat in the bottom right corner. Okay, there are already the first questions.
So, shall I already start with the first question?
Yes, please.
So, the question is if filtering doesn't remove important signals. So, this is true, the filtering removes important signals, and this is also a reason why we have that course with solution later. But within this filtering, there are different techniques that also try to get this signal back. So, for example, you can apply rescaling after that filtering. And this rescaling is also connected to hydrological models. So, the solutions that we have available on our website are not rescaled yet, but you can rescale them after you decide for a model. Okay, I think the second question is also for me. The earthquake removal does affect the results. There are some publications that show the effect on geoid heights and other parts, and this is but only relevant for large earthquakes. So. There are earthquakes like which have a magnitude of I don't know how the scalar is called, so it's M9 earthquakes called, and we only remove the effects of those large earthquakes, not of slower earthquakes. And is the effect visible when the final resolution of the product is 300 kilometers times 300 kilometers? Yet you can see these effects. I don't know the name. I think it was a publication of Bruse et al., or dissertation, that showed that this effect is visible, but also other publications already showed this effect. Okay, sorry.
So we have somebody who wants to speak. A Pereira. Hello, can you? Hmm. maybe you can just continue with the next.
Okay. I think the third one is again for me. So are you validating the hydrological drought indicator against, for example, the palm drought indicator? This question is kind of yes and no, because we look at the palm drought indicator and SPI and other meteorological drought indicators, but we need to say that this is not directly a validation, because these indicators are first also not validated, because we have no ground truth about droughts. We have only ground truth about precipitation and temperature and so on. And the second thing is that these indicators are meteorological indicators, and there is also a difference between meteorological drought and hydrological drought, because hydrological drought is, as I explained, relevant for storages, and meteorological drought is relevant for precipitation and temperature. And fourth question, are the GRACE results still observations after all the post-processing? Yes, sure. I would say this is sure, because this is relevant for all time series analysis that is done at different institutes and for different topics, because post-processing needs to be done to also remove signals that you don't want to have contained in the time series at the end. But this processing also has, not the processing has errors, but these errors changes within the processing. So we also need a kind of error propagation that needs to be considered after all this post-processing. Would large. Okay, I do not know how we should answer about the link. I cannot open it. So I would maybe give a very general answer first, the model is not our model. We only use it together with Frankfurt. So this model belongs to them. And we are mainly relevant and responsible for the GRACE part. Yeah, and I do not know the modification in the project, so maybe you could describe them a little bit, that I maybe could understand what effects it could have on the models. But as I said, I'm not the expert for the models, but for the observations. How can GRACE be used in flooding? I'm also not an expert for flooding, so you can say that you can make a time series analysis. You can always make a time series analysis and look only at the time series if you see wetter events than before. And maybe you could also adapt some techniques that I used in drought identification, like standardization methods and percentile methods. So you could also maybe adapt these methods to flooding, but I'm no expert in flooding. Do you still hear me? Because I cannot hear some noise.
I can hear you.
Oh yeah, no, yeah, okay, thank you. The next questions, I think maybe you could reformulate it. I'm not really getting the point. So the question about the magnetosphere and the filtering. I think I can answer the next question. Why do you make your own processing of level 2 instead of directly using level 3 products already available? So we do processing by our own because with this processing we can make sure that we use the filter that we want to use and that we also want to get the spatial average time period as we want to have it, and there are other effects like the earthquake removal that is not done in other solutions. So this is why we do our post-processing by ourselves. And the last question, I did not work with level 1B data. Maybe this is a question for Frank.
Can you hear us, Helena?
Yes, I hear you now, but
okay.
I did not hear Frank.
Frank, can you?
Yeah, I hear you.
Oh, okay, now.
Now I hear you.
Sorry.
But you didn't hear my answer.
I did not hear it. I don't know how the others.
No.
Yeah, I could shortly repeat what I have said before. So there was a project funded by the European Commission where we indeed used level 1B data together with local base functions to describe flooding indicators or to detect flooding indicators. And indeed, we showed that you could get some nice results using this kind of modeling instead of using spherical harmonic coefficients. I could also answer the next question. There was the question, what comes after Grace follow-on? So indeed, there was a workshop last month in Washington on a future mass change mission. And there is a plan, not between GFZ and NASA, but likely between ESA and NASA to fly a double pair mission if the minister conference in November agrees to that. I would say that is the next step forward to realize such kind of mission. And I'm totally optimistic that something will come up after the end of Grace follow-on, which is in a few years from now. If it is again a single pair mission or a double pair mission or whatever, there are also other architectures which have been simulated, we will see.
Okay, the next question is, in the example Kammer filter I showed the observation part, is it an observation of the total water storage So yes, this observation part was the GRACE total water storage changes that we add there. So then we combine it to the model.
Okay, so Sean has added some details to his question about the intervention in China and also about the magnetosphere question. So I don't know if it becomes clearer now to answer it.
Could you put the arrow on the beginning? I don't know where the beginning of the question is.
It's just here some explanation about the...
Oh, yeah.
Oops.
Okay, if I understood it correctly, we have some effects, so correct me if I say it wrong now, of so they have tons of sodium iodide that lead to larger precipitation and effects in the atmosphere, and you are asking now if it is detectable in GRACE, right? So yes, then I would say huge precipitation events are detectable in GRACE because, so not the precipitation events, but the effect on the storages. So if the precipitation leads to a higher storage in, for example, the lake or the groundwater, then you can maybe see it. But I don't know how large these effects are, so I can also not say if we can see it in GRACE, because we do not also did not already looked at such effects, and I did not hear about them. So my main answer would be if they are huge enough to lead to storage changes, then yes, but I cannot say that I have already seen such effects. Okay. I now take the question of is the model WGFM available for other researchers, universities? So as I said, this is not our model. This is the model of the hydrological group in University of Frankfurt, and they have the model, but if you want to know something about the model, you should always ask them. I'm not sure about these things. And the lowest question here, in ensemble Kammann filter, how about the error covariance matrix? That's what give you the weight for the weighted average. Yes, that's true. So you also compare both error covariance matrices of the states. How do I get the errors of total water storage? So I see this question in the chat now. I take the error of the spherical harmonic coefficients, so the potential coefficients, and then I compute error propagation for the steps that I have contained in my processing.
I see also that Sean was clarifying his question a bit more about whether the filtered out data might have been something. It's in the chat as well. I mean, maybe you could also try to rephrase the question and ask it later in the discussion forum, so we can have a look at it. I'm talking to Sean now, because he seems to have a lot of questions. So if you could, because he will open the discussion forum on the learning platform later, so you can maybe ask your question there. And yeah, maybe that's a question to both of you. I think it's okay if we publish your slides on the learning platform.
Yes, that's okay for me. So
I would exclude one slide of my presentation.
Yes, of
yeah, I would
course.
also include some slides at the end.
Okay, we can look at that later. But also the recording of the webinar will be available online. So if you want to refer to or want to look back at the slide there, you can also look in the recording. Okay. Otherwise, are there any more questions? Because we are already out of time, so if there isn't anything else, I would like to say thank you to our both presenters and to everybody who has joined us today. And yes, as already said, there will be a discussion forum online. If you just go to the learning platform, to the learning block, and there is going to be, or it's already there, a link discussion forum, so you can ask your questions there. And otherwise, so we are, there's going to be like a summer break now, and the next learning block is going to be later this year, probably around November. And until then, yeah, use the discussion forums and see you then. Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Bye.